I guess I'll say two things by way of beginning. One is that perhaps it's okay to start first with an African precursor to Garvey, which is a reminder that some of these debates that we frame between Garvey and Du Bois really shouldn't overdetermine Pan-Africanism, which was already percolating on the continent and really demanded their response. So sometimes we get a sense of, you know, an inverted order, even though there's a lot of conversation and dialogue in West Africa, especially about these issues. So the second thing I'll say is a slight correction, which is that I do come to this topic by way of family, but it's not because my family were African-American migrants. My father's an African, he's a Ghanaian from Anamabu, grew up there. He's also a Sam. And so, you know, really the story of Chief Sam has always been a puzzle to us. And, you know, it served as an interesting way for me to ask questions, to look at the holes in family history and to go around and talk to chiefs who really obliged me as I tried to piece together different elements of this story. But the outcome of that was not a family history, it was actually a movement history. So that's what I want to talk a little bit more about today. You know, Chief Sam was someone who I first encountered not through my family, but through a journal article that I found at the University of Ghana. And, you know, it was about the African movement, but I was surprised when I asked around that he was not a commonly known figure in Ghana. In recent years, that's been changing, perhaps because I peddle this a bit. But, you know, he was an African merchant who was born in 1880. And really raised between sort of the central region in Salt Pond. Oh, sorry, is there, do we need to put some mute on? Okay. So he was raised between the coast and Salt Pond and Apasa, which is this small Achim village inland. And in between that, he was sent to the Basel Seminary in Akrapong. And there he really sharpened this idea that a religious mission really needed a business mission. All churches needed income to survive. So his best friend, who was Joseph Drybold Taylor from Anamabo, he had been sent to the US for training with the AME Zion Church at Livingston College. He was one of the first generation of African missionaries to get training there. And eventually he took over Thomas Birch Freeman Jr.'s church in Quetta, which was, you know, really the first AMEZ church in the Gold Coast. And, you know, Sam also had a trading office there, and they would have long conversations about what their visions were for travel, for evangelism. But most importantly, what Freeman taught them and what Taylor really fortified was the importance of diasporic reunion. So the AME Zion Church was really a provocation to be thinking about what is the relationship between African Americans and Africans. And keeping this in mind, that churches were always in need of cash and ministers had to be businessmen too. Taylor and Sam were not just friends, they were also business partners. And so they talked about ways to bring African Americans to the Gold Coast and really ways that they wanted to re-engineer the Liberian model to really feature indigenous African leadership and to integrate African Americans into African polities. And, you know, J.E. Casely Hayford would capture this a bit later when he would say, we want Africans, not so much Afro-Americans. And so that was the idea of bringing people home and claiming them as Africans. So this idea was really nurtured over many years, and it was Taylor who organized Sam's first trip to the U.S. In 1909. He returned in 1911, where he stayed in Brooklyn, gave lectures on African culture. And eventually he moved to Weeksville, which is an old Black neighborhood in Brooklyn. And he filed for corporate recognition to found a Pan-African trading company with partners that he made there. And this is all in the space of about 6 months. So he toured the country, and one of his business partners, Charles Chappelle, who was an architect, who shuttled between Weeksville and Pittsburgh, really expanded the plan. He said, no, we don't need just a trading company for timber or rubber or cocoa. We should plan to evolve the infrastructure in West Africa. We should think about a railroad. We should think about electricity. We should really think about cities. And this actually was the beginning of the big vision, I think. I'm not sure Sam had all of the pieces in place, but these partnerships really sedimented something for him. But as they toured the country, they found that the idea didn't really catch on until Sam started talking about emigration. So at this point, the original board members were not a fan of emigration first. They disagreed with this additional mission, but Sam was determined and he went ahead talking about it. And there was greater interest in buying stock in the company as a result of highlighting emigration. So eventually that board in Weeksville fired Sam from his own company. And he did what Garvey would later do, which is just reincorporate the company and start over again and detach himself from those people. But this time he was publicly announcing, we're going to build a shipping line, a planned city, transnational trade, colleges, and a mail service that would connect the US, the Caribbean, and West Africa. So this was really a pivot that was inspired by these early partnerships, but then ruptured from them a little bit because the new board was all African. They were drawn from the Gold Coast. They were drawn from Liberia. They were intent on cultivating a mass movement supported by hundreds of emigration clubs. And in the next 18 months, they raised nearly $100,000. Now, in 1914, that was almost inconceivable for an unknown figure to just come into town and raise that much money. But Sam proceeded and he bought a ship from Cuba. It was a German made ship. And even as it was brought into the Brooklyn Harbor, Du Bois is busy writing editorials in the crisis, really scathing critiques of Sam, saying there is no ship, there is no Black company building for the African trade. This is not happening, but it certainly was. And by this time, Garvey arrived in Harlem and he set up shop really a few blocks away from Sam. So Sam had rented office space from Philip Payton, right, on 125th Street. So this is when Harlem is becoming Black, block by block. And so Sam is at the heart of these cultural changes, Black neighborhood building, and this concerted effort to build Pan-African businesses. His former business partner, Charles Chappelle, he eventually relocates himself to the Gold Coast. He lives in Secondy. They eventually meet again in the middle of the migrants, you know, as the migrants are starting to settle. And he is still actively campaigning for a railroad. So this really shows the energy and vision of a collective of people, not just one individual, but people who were sometimes collaborating, sometimes competing with each other. But these enterprises all share the same root. So Du Bois, even though he was really condemning the project as an impractical mission, Sam really was quite practical. He survived fraud accusations, multiple lawsuits, and you know, we would see this with Garvey too, but Sam actually won his cases, and he managed to get the ship repaired and docked in Galveston, Texas for the first delegation to board. That ship was christened the SS Liberia in a nod to former movements. And the young woman who christened the ship, Mary Lucille Garrett, would become Sam's wife and they would marry in the Gold Coast. So off they sail in 1914 in August. So you can already imagine the timing is unfortunate. World War I is certainly something that is beginning to bubble up and they're considering it. They're trying to factor this into their plans, but really it doesn't change the ultimate mission. They make several stops to pick up passengers, first in Virginia, then in Florida, and then they head to Barbados. They do also stop and do some trade in Cuba. They refuel in Cape Verde, which, you know, is the site of one of Sam's offices. And there, the British Navy stops them and says, what is this German ship? Why do you have a wireless? You know, and this actually is the cause for them saying, we have to investigate and you need to sail straight to Sierra Leone so we can have a martial trial. And at this point, they do go to Sierra Leone. They stop in the Gambia first. But in each place, they're just spending money. Money they never planned to spend. They are, on the other hand, recruiting a lot of support. from people who really weren't quite believing in the movement until they showed up on shore. So in this sense, you know, they were very compelling and persuasive, and eventually they win this case too, and they're free to sail to Cape Coast. But when they arrive in Cape Coast, they are told everyone must pay a head tax. Now, between the time they left Texas and the time they arrive in the Cape Coast, the Legislative Council has passed an immigration head tax, which is a first for the colony. It's the beginning of immigration policy, and it's prompted by African-American migration. Now, because plenty of migrants from the west of Africa, from Brazil, from the Middle East, from the Caribbean and the Mediterranean are all living in the Gold Coast, this is an unusual concept. They didn't have to pay a head tax. So it's worth noting that African-American migration to the Gold Coast appears on the one hand to inaugurate new policy that really shapes a new era, but it's also belated in this light, right? Because they come after folks have already come in the 19th century from Brazil, and migrants from the Caribbean who were educated in England arrive in the early 20th century under the banner of a kind of emergent Pan-Africanism. So really, African Americans arrive in the Gold Coast only at the invitation of an African organizing their return. So when Sam and Garvey, what they have in common at this particular juncture is that African elites in the Gold Coast really had a preferential approach to diasporic return until this moment. They really didn't want everyone. And Garvey and Sam really both had a vision of mass return, not vetted, just whoever wanted to come. And so what we end up with in Ghana today, I think, is really a hybrid vision of the two, where diasporic citizenship is really selectively doled out, and then tourism is aimed at the masses. So the head tax is really what pivots African elite opinion in this juncture, and that it becomes clear on arrival that this policy only really applies to African Americans. So some have put a bond for the ship to dock in Salt Pond, and so now the elites have a vested interest in repealing the policy. So let me just cut to the quick here, because the question that I had when I started doing this research is, what happened to these migrants and why do we know so little about them? First, I think we know some very enticing details thanks to Robert Hill and his partnership with James Nkwanda, who really introduced fresh information in the 1980s. But I was really interested in knowing more and what was behind that information. So I sought out Professor Nkwanda and he gave me his original notes. And I then tracked down every lead in the little scrawled margins of those notes to find out what was happening and where everyone spread out. So it turned out that Sam had a very unusual kind of idea about kinship. And he really understood African Americans having to arrive and be claimed as Africans in a spiritual reunion. And this was a ritual that he enacted at several villages on the way to the land that he bought for their settlement. And so he actually just borrowed from Thomas Birch Freeman Jr.'s language, and he would say in each village, these people are bone of your bone, flesh of your flesh. They've come to live and die with you. And so it was a very moving ritual, but it does eventually end in tragedy. So this is probably how most people remember Chief Sam's African movement. A handful of migrants, about a dozen, they return in 1915, just 6 months after arriving. They're broke, they're struggling to figure out where to go during World War I. The ship has no access to fuel, it can't move, it can't conduct trade. Their land is tied up in court. And so the newspapers in the US at least cover these migrants and say the movement is a failure, Sam is a fraud, he couldn't follow through. So, you know, and really what happens is that the head tax drives a lot of people undercover. So what we don't see is that there are a number of people who marry into African families who do not say they are American, who stop saying they are American, and others move on to Nigeria, some move on to Sierra Leone, and others move on to Liberia. Sam himself moved to Liberia in the 1920s. So really the majority of people who were part of this movement remained in West Africa, and a good number actually stayed in the Gold Coast. But unfortunately, in 1918, most of those people succumbed to the flu pandemic of 1918. So what we have is really likely rich sources of oral history that are eviscerated. And so the chief of Salt Pond really gave an interview to Professor Nkwande and said he remembered that Chief Sam's marriage nearly collapsed under the stress of the migrants' deaths from that flu. So, you know, really what we have is a situation where we could have known more were it not for that situation. And so there are different ways to get at the information aside from that. I think the lesson perhaps in all of this is that we can now contextualize African-American return to Ghana with its own distinct trajectory and understand that it evolved from a Pan-African business proposal that developed much later than migrants from Brazil or the Caribbean. But as such, it really happened right before Garvey's eyes. So due to the bad press from those returned migrants, Garvey threatened people who, and he sued journalists who mentioned Sam's name alongside his own. And so that's really what I think explains the rupture between our understanding of Chief Sam's African movement and Garvey's UNIA movement, because they're so intimately referencing each other, and yet it's hard to hold them together in the record. So I think that even though everyone made the comparison at the time, nobody was trying to get sued in the black press. So that's in some sense a reason why we can rectify this today. And I'll just, there's so much more to say about this movement, but I'll close there. And I don't mind elaborating on any of these points in the Q&A.
Thank you so much. And I'm sure we'll get back to many of these questions left. Chad Williams, will you please go next? Expert on Mr. Du Bois and the Army and everything between.
Okay, it looks like I'm up. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Thank you, Napoleon, for pulling us together. Thank you, Ibrahim. My esteemed predecessor, I always remain in your debt and gratitude for the foundation you have laid for me and AAAS. So
whenever you happen to a better person.
Yeah, I mean, whenever you ask me to do anything, I have to say yes. So that's the only reason I'm here, is because of you. So. but also, a great honor to be with Robert and Ebony. Learn so much from their respective works. So I'm going to try and share my screen here. It looks like host has disabled screen sharing for the moment, so maybe I can get that corrected for me. But as Professor Sundiata said, my specific area of focus is indeed on W.B. Du Bois. W.B. Du Bois in the context of the World War I era. And I'd like to focus my remarks on Du Bois in relation to Garvey, and really kind of focus on this question of leadership, which I think really comes to a head in 1920 through the competing personas of Marcus Garvey and W.B. Du Bois, but also through their competing agendas, their competing movements, their competing approaches to the question of Black leadership and diasporic uplift. So I think I'm able to share my screen there. Okay. So I want to start with this actually pretty evocative or provocative quote from Du Bois in the pages of the Crisis magazine, the Journal of the NAACP, which he edited for so many years, in an article that he titled Lunatic or Traitor, devoted to Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey is without doubt the most dangerous enemy of the Negro race in America and in the world. That should be America there. So the question that I think we need to ask, and this is Du Bois writing in 1924, is how he got to this point. And he had much more to say about Garvey, believe me. And Garvey had much more to say about him. By 1924, they were very close to being mortal enemies. They had a venomous feud in the Black press, made incredibly disparaging remarks about each other. It was ugly. So why did their relationship kind of devolve, or how did their relationship devolve to the point where Garvey saw Du Bois as nothing short of a traitor to the race, not authentically Black, and Du Bois seeing Garvey as the most dangerous Negro in the world? I think we need to focus specifically on 1920, which was indeed a critical year in their feud. And as I said, it was really rooted in a contest for leadership, specifically in the context of what came to be known as the New Negro Movement. This kind of period of Black political activism, of kind of cultural activism as well, we want to connect it to the Harlem Renaissance, in which kind of new ideas and new movements of Black pride, but also Black freedom, Black political organization, were being expressed in new radical ways. So the question in this context was, who was going to be the man? Who was going to be the voice of the new Negro? And this was what Garvey and Du Bois were contending with through their competing visions of Pan-African unity and uplift. Who was going to lead Black people of the diaspora in the immediate aftermath of the First World War? So I want to focus specifically on this context. And particularly in the case of Du Bois, look at how the war and post-war years were really some of the most pivotal of his career, and indeed even of his life. I see this period as really the most significant test of his leadership and radical credibility, and that had everything to do with Marcus Garvey. So Du Bois initially paid Marcus Garvey very little attention. The relationship between Du Bois and Garvey began cordially enough in April of 1915, when the leader of the upstart Universal Negro Improvement Association wrote a very gracious note to Du Bois, welcoming him to Jamaica. Du Bois was vacationing in Jamaica in 1915, and hoped that Du Bois had, in Garvey's words, an enjoyable visit to his sunny isle. Du Bois didn't write him back. Garvey again reached out to Du Bois a year later when he relocated to New York City. He stopped by the offices of the NAACP and invited the editor of The Crisis to preside over his first public lecture that he was giving on May the 9th, 1916 at St. Mark's Hall. Du Bois was absent from the office that day and through his assistant informed Garvey that while he appreciated the invitation, he was unable to attend. And it may have been in Garvey's best interest that Du Bois wasn't there, because Garvey actually literally fell flat on his face during his first public speech in New York City. It was a pretty disastrous first public appearance. But nevertheless, he would recover and quickly begin to make a name for himself. 1 year after that exchange, in April 1917, the United States entered the First World War. And this was, I would argue, the crucible in which Garvey's leadership stature rose, particularly in the context of the United States and Black folk in the United States. But it was also a period in which Du Bois's credibility and his leadership was really tested like never before. Du Bois supported the war, believed that the war would indeed make the world safer democracy. He felt that it was a moment in which Black people can prove their worth as Americans and kind of stake claim to an ideal of democracy that would indeed include them as American citizens. Needless to say, not all African Americans felt this way, and as it became evidently clear, democracy was going to need to be fought for on American soil, not just on the battlefields of France. That became very clear in July of 1917, the East St. Louis riot, one of the most horrific racial pogroms in American history. This was a moment in which Garvey recognized just how distant democracy was from the lives, from the realities of Black people in the United States. And he tapped into that growing democratic disillusionment, the growing rage that African Americans felt in the context of the war, while Du Bois tried his best to steady the ship, so to speak, and to try and keep African Americans focused on the task at hand, the vision of democracy that lay at the end of the American war effort. Du Bois's leadership and legitimacy, however, was really brought to the brink of ruin when he published probably his most controversial essay in the pages of The Crisis, Close Ranks, in July of 1918, in which he stated in part, "We of the colored race have no ordinary interest in the outcome." Right? That which the German power represents today spells death to the aspirations of Negroes and all darker races for equality, freedom, and democracy. Let us not hesitate. Let us, while this war lasts, forget our special grievances and close our ranks with our own white fellow citizens and the allied nations that are fighting for democracy. We make no ordinary sacrifice, but we make it gladly and willingly with our eyes lifted to the hills. So needless to say, most African Americans were not willing to forget their special grievances and to make the type of sacrifice that Du Bois was asking them to make. And as a result, Du Bois was dragged mercilessly in the Black press and amongst many of his colleagues and fellow radicals. William Monroe Trotter essentially called Du Bois a traitor to the race, a deserter, a rank quitter of the fight for rights. He betrays his race in the Great Crisis. And Du Bois and Trotter, who was editor of the Boston Guardian, one of the most radical voices of the pre-war period and continuing throughout the war and post-war period, was a close friend and collaborator of Du Bois. But the war really revealed the ideological tensions and put a strain on many of the relationships that had previously existed prior to the war. So radicals like William Monroe Trotter, lambasted Du Bois. Garvey was amongst the chorus who criticized Du Bois. And really, we see this distinction being made between a generation of Black leaders, which Du Bois represented, and through the NAACP, the old guard, right, the old Negro, and the emerging new Negro that Garvey gave voice to, as well as other radical voices like Hubert Harrison, A. Philip Randolph, and others, right? So African Americans and other peoples of African descent, you know, begin to sour on Du Bois, begin to question his radical credentials, but also question the agenda of the NAACP and other old guard civil rights organizations. So by the end of the war, Garvey is packing lecture halls throughout New York and up and down the East Coast. The UNIA is growing exponentially. And Du Bois is looking for a way to rehabilitate himself. His credibility in many respects is shot amongst radicals in the United States. So he makes the strategic decision to go to France and to specifically hold a Pan-African Congress in February of 1919. He was one of the few African Americans to receive a passport to travel to France. Garvey, as well as other radicals like William Monroe Trotter, Ida B. Wells, Madam C.J. Walker, were denied the opportunity to travel to France for the Versailles peace proceedings, as well as for the Pan-African Congress. Du Bois cut a bunch of side deals. There's a much longer story to that, and was able to get a passport to go to France, where he held a really historic Pan-African Congress, really the second Pan-African Congress. The first took place in 1900. But in the context of the Pan-African movement, which Du Bois would try and stake claim to through a series of congresses that he would held that he would hold, the first being in 1919, others subsequently happened in 1921, 1923, 1925. This was really a landmark moment. But it also reflected the kind of conservatism of Du Bois's vision of Pan-Africanism, his own elitism, his idea that African Americans were uniquely suited to be the leaders of the diaspora, and how he adopted even many of the civilizationist ideas of the very European powers that he was ostensibly critiquing in Paris in those months that he was there. Marcus Garvey was not happy to be excluded from the Pan-African Congress, so to speak. He had a what he deemed as a special representative, Eliezer Cadet, who was envisioned to be kind of his hand-chosen delegate to the Versailles peace proceedings, as well as to attend the Pan-African Congress. He accused Du Bois of sabotaging Cadet's influence in Paris during that time. So this was really kind of the beginnings of their feud in relation to their respective visions of Pan-Africanism. In justifying Garvey's absence from the Pan-African Congress, Du Bois wrote in a letter to the New York Age, an African-American newspaper based in New York, and stressed that his efforts, and I quote, had nothing to do with any Africa for the Africans movement, right? His Pan-African Congress had nothing to do with any Africa for the Africans movement, and characterized the work of Garvey as, quote, dangerous, ill-considered, and impractical, right? So we begin to again see like how the groundwork is being laid, but it's really based in a competition over who is going to be the voice of Pan-Africa, right? Who is going to be the voice of kind of two competing visions of Pan-African liberation and movement, right? And connectivity, right? As Ebony was alluding to, right? Who is going to bring the diaspora together and how is that going to be done? As Garvey's influence continues to grow, Du Bois continues to try and assert his legitimacy, particularly in the context of the post-war period and the very volatile months of 1919 in the context of the Red Summer, which race riots, lynchings really sweep the country, Chicago, Washington, D.C., Elaine, Arkansas, other places. It becomes clear that the war for democracy that Du Bois had championed was, you know, essentially a failure as far as African-American rights were concerned. So Garvey taps into this mood that's sweeping Black America, that's sweeping the diaspora, this mood of disillusionment, also this mood of Black resistance as well, right? You know, captured so famously in Claude McKay's poem, We Return Fighting. Du Bois, you know, was not connected to the zeitgeist in the same way that Marcus Garvey was, right? If you attended a speech that Marcus Garvey was giving, participants described it as magic, right? It was like his voice was speaking to you, was speaking through you. That Du Bois didn't possess that type of magic, that type of connection to the masses of ordinary Black folk, right? Garvey had the gift of oratory in a way that Du Bois certainly didn't. But Du Bois had the gift of words. He had the gift of the pen. And in 1920, he published what he described, or what he characterized as the sequel to Souls of Black Folk, his most famous book published in 1903, still considered one of the classic texts of American literature, certainly a staple of African-American studies. Darkwater was kind of seen as the sequel to Souls of Black Folk, very similar in terms of structure, previously published essays, but it was more experimental than Souls of Black Folk, combining poetry, short stories. But I would argue that Darkwater was in some ways Du Bois staking claim to his his leadership within the context of the New Negro Movement, right? In some ways, this was his manifesto, his statement that he was still a voice to be reckoned with. The tone of Darkwater really reflects the mood of 1919, in which he finished the final revisions for the text, right? It is very dark. It is very haunting, right, in many ways. And reviewers and critics really noted the radicalism that ran throughout the text, especially in terms of how Du Bois wrote about the kind of continued scourge of racial violence that African Americans were continuing to have to battle. So Darkwater was a key text, 1920, that really played a very significant role in kind of rehabilitating Du Bois's image and his radical credentials. It was absolutely necessary because the UNIA and Garvey are really reaching their apex in some ways. In 1920, in August of 1920, the UNI organizes the first international conference of Negro peoples in Harlem. This was a tremendous gathering, 25,000 people assembled in Madison Square Garden. The mayor of Monrovia, Liberia, was in attendance. Garvey declared himself the provisional president of Africa during this gathering. So it was a massive kind of spectacle. And interestingly enough, it's believed that Du Bois was in the audience in Madison Square Garden that day, which spoke to how by 1920, he was keeping a very close eye on Garvey. Right? He knew that he had a problem on his hands. He had not responded to many of Garvey's barbs that Garvey had been lobbying in the Negro world, as well as in his speeches. But by the end of 1920, Du Bois really had no choice but to publicly assess Garvey and the UNIA in the pages of the crisis. Privately, he knew that Garvey was, in his opinion, not to be trusted. I think we see kind of similarities with Chief Sam, this idea that these charismatic figures were somehow going to be deluding the susceptible masses of Black folk, right? And he saw, I think, Garvey in that same tradition. Initially, Du Bois was actually very measured in his critiques of Garvey in the pages of the crisis. In one article in late 1920, he described Garvey as essentially an honest and sincere man with tremendous vision, great dynamic force, stubborn determination, and unselfish desire to serve. But when it came to Garvey's personality, his very bombastic personality, his temperament, as well as his very questionable financial skills, Du Bois found many examples to criticize. He said, quote, "The great difficulty with him is that he has absolutely no business sense, no flair for real organization, and his general objects are so shot through with bombast and exaggeration that it's difficult to pin them down for careful examination." And he was thinking specifically about the Black Star Line, Garvey's shipping vision, right, of creating a fleet of ships that would sail throughout the diaspora, right, connecting dispersed Black folks throughout the diaspora in merchandise, commercial endeavors, but also in repatriation as well. He was particularly concerned, Du Bois was particularly concerned about Garvey's influence on the masses, and again, reflecting Du Bois's elitism. Garvey is the beloved leader of tens of thousands of poor and bewildered people who have been cheated all their lives. His failure would mean a blow to their faith and a loss of their little savings, which it would take generations to undo. So he felt that in terms of his leadership skills, Garvey was not only lacking, but was a tremendous threat to the masses of Black folk. He also knew that any punishment that Garvey received in the eyes of the Black public would benefit him personally. So this would be the start of a protracted campaign to discredit Garvey while elevating himself in the process. And as we saw earlier, their war of words would get much worse, much more personal. Garvey certainly didn't do himself any favors through mismanagement of the Black Star Line, personal feuds with other Black leaders, even flirting with the Ku Klux Klan. This would all culminate in him being charged with mail fraud by the federal government, imprisoned, and ultimately deported. But I think we need to understand how we got to that point and why this moment matters, because I think we are still in a moment when we are grappling with the meaning of Black leadership and how we think about Black leadership in the context of racial crisis. This moment of tension, this feud between Du Bois and Garvey really speaks to how leadership within the context of Black freedom movements has always been contested, and I think provides some instructive lessons for how we could think about this moment in the broader context of the diaspora today. So I will end there.
Thank you so much, Jed. You gave us, and thank you also for the visuals, which are really great. And
I'm teaching now, so it's all about visuals.
All right.
The students paying attention.
All right. Robert, you are up next. If you're there.
I am here.
All right. And good to see you.
All right. Thank you. Good to see everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. Wonderful to listen to Ebony and Chad. I will pick up the story where Chad left off, talking a bit more about Marcus Garvey and the UNIA and why his movement was so attractive to Africans, in this case, South Africa. So in this way, it also connects to Ebony's presentation with Chief Sam, return to Africa, connections with African-Americans and Africans, but in this case, for Southern Africa. So for the UNIA, this moment of 1920, Du Bois writes his manifesto, Darkwater. And in a way, Garvey writes his own manifesto through his oratory, but also through this 1920 conference, the UNIA conference, where there is a Declaration of Rights of Negro Peoples of the World. And in this way, Du Bois and Garvey are both critiquing, deeply criticizing empire, colonial empire, the British empires, the French empires. Of course, America has a colonial empire in the aftermath of the Spanish-American War. So they're both critiquing empire. They're both critiquing white supremacy, the refusal in the post-war moment to apply the principle of self-determination to people of color, to nations of color, right? So they are both deeply anti-colonial in their views. But as Chad has mentioned, there was some diversion on method and how to do that. And so Garvey's Declaration of Rights of the Negro Peoples of the World is really a declaration of independence from these global forms of white supremacy against the global color line that Du Bois himself had spoken of. So on the Black side of this global color line was this developing Pan-Africanism that had really gone back into the 19th century, hearkening back to the inspirational example of the Haitian Revolution, anti-slavery revolts. And so Garveyism in many ways is a consolidation of earlier Pan-African currents and traditions. It is benefiting from transatlantic interactions between Africans and those of the African diaspora. And so Garvey is the beneficiary of all this ongoing Pan-African activity. And he consolidates this in this very bold, audacious slogan, Africa for the Africans, which speaks to the idea of African independence, decolonize Africa, also speaking to the end of Jim Crow segregation, wherever it may exist, including the United States. And so it's speaking of a type of Black political independence, economic power and strength, control over Black cultural and religious and educational institutions, Black self-determination in a global sense. And it's making the argument that Black peoples need to unite across borders in a transnational way, in a global way, to defeat the global nature of white supremacy. So this bold, audacious vision galvanizes people all over the world, Black people all over the world. And some scholars argue that The Garvey movement was the largest Black-led movement in world history, with an estimated 2 million members and supporters in 43 countries, over 1,000 chapters of the UNIA. So the UNIA is this global institution and organization, but the ideas that become known as Garveyism, this idea of Black political and economic independence and autonomy, these ideas of Garveyism go even further than the institutional basis of the UNIA. And we see that as these ideas of Garveyism move around the world, and they're spread mostly by mobile Black people, Black sailors, Black laborers, soldiers, Black soldiers from all over the world who were finding themselves in theaters of war in Europe or in North Africa and comparing notes about their local situation of being colonized or Jim Crowed, and were making these global connections. So where we find mobile Black people, we find them spreading the gospel of Garveyism. And they're doing it orally, and they're also doing it through Garvey's newspaper, The Negro World, which is published in three different languages, English, French, and Spanish. And so orally and through print culture, Garveyism is spreading around the world. And in many ways, Garveyism is a type of potter's clay, because wherever you find Garveyites, whether it be in the Caribbean or the US or in Europe or in Africa, they're retrofitting Garveyism, this diasporic ideology, to fit local context, to make it make sense. So you can agree with the broad ideas of Black independence, Black power, right? But you localize it, you indigenize it to fit a particular local circumstance. So in the case of South Africa, Black sailors are bringing these ideas of Garveyism into the port cities of South Africa. We find Black dock workers, many of whom came from the Caribbean, who lived in these port cities, who were receiving these ideas of Garveyism, and then translating these ideas of Garveyism into establishing UNIA chapters in South Africa and taking it into Black trade unions. The largest trade union was the Industrial and Commercial Workers Union in South Africa, the African National Congress, which became the leading anti-apartheid political organization and is now the governing party of South Africa. So we see Garveyism coming into not only just UNIA chapters, but also Black trade unions, Black political organizations, and Black churches, including the African Methodist Episcopal Church, an African American denomination already established in South Africa. And we see Garveyism as part of a longer prophetic tradition, the idea that liberation could come from overseas, from Black peoples overseas. And so this idea of American Negro liberation, the idea that Blacks overseas would join up with Africans to create a sort of apocalyptic vision of liberation, right? These ideas of prophecy derived primarily from the Bible, using examples of the biblical Israelites who had been enslaved and then liberated. These ideas of ultimate deliverance were very powerful within the Garvey movement. So there was a religious dynamic that was very, very strong. So in these ways then, Garveyism extends throughout South Africa in these multiple dimensions and continues the 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, even after Garvey himself has legal difficulties, is jailed, is eventually deported to Jamaica. The UNIA as an institution does not in the 1930s and 40s have the same power that it did in the 1920s. But Garveyism as an ideology, as an idea, continues on because South Africans had indigenized it and used it for their own purposes. So Garveyism as a set of liberationist practices and ideas lives on even as the UNIA chapters themselves begin to diminish. Now, I will say that the enduring vision of Garveyism in the UNIA continue in South Africa today. There is a settlement outside of Cape Town called Marcus Garvey. There are still UNIA chapters in South Africa. There are many more who consider themselves Garveyites in South Africa. And I guess we can elaborate more in the Q&A. I think the essential point that we want to take away is that Garveyism is an enduring ideology, just as it consolidated earlier Pan-African currents of thought, it also was a type of incubator for later day Black Power movements. And so we see connections with the Garvey movement and Black religious formations, like the Moorish Science Temple. We see the influence amongst Black Power icons like Malcolm X, whose parents were Garveyites, right? And so the ideas of Garveyism were not only consolidating earlier Pan-African currents, but also incubating and is used as sort of a fulcrum to consider later day decolonization movements and Black Power movements. The idea of Africa for Africans, the idea of an independent Africa, Garvey would not live to see that. He died in 1940. But in many ways, he was extraordinarily influential in the age of decolonization because Africans like Kwame Nkrumah, who, as Ebony mentioned, is part of an educational network of Africans studying in American universities, particularly historically Black universities, like in Nkrumah's case, Lincoln University. In the case of Nnamdi Azikiwe, the first president of Nigeria, Lincoln University. And so Kwame Nkrumah, who earned 2 degrees at Lincoln University in the 1930s, and led the decolonization movements in what was then the Gold Coast, now Ghana, always articulated the idea that in all of his readings, the book that was the most important to him, the most influential, was The Philosophy and Opinions of Marcus Garvey. By the way, edited by Amy Jakes Garvey, his second wife. So when we talk about the legacy of Garveyism, it is tied to the moment of decolonization as well. Kwame Nkrumah, independent Ghana, continues the Pan-African mantle of Garvey, invites Du Bois to live in Ghana, which he does, and lives his final days. So that connection of Nkrumah with Garvey and Du Bois, Kwame Nkrumah names his naval fleet, the national fleet, the Black Star Line, after Garvey's UNIA Black Star Line. And so those connections are there when we look at the UNIA and Garveyism and its lasting impact in African decolonization movements and Black Power movements in America and other parts of the world. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Robert. Thank you very much. Now we have time for Q&A, but before we do that, I just want to, we have some very provocative questions already. One was, why the title of this panel? Are we still complaining? And to that question, which we may not get back to, is Garvey said that if if people in the diaspora, not just African Americans, don't have a nation, they would always be victimized. And so it may, in 100 years, we'd still be complaining. In 100 years, these problems would still go on. He said there'll be immigration and African Americans will be a declining percentage of population. And eventually, as that happens, whatever little political power they might have had, or we might have had, is going to go. So he was saying, follow my, you know, let's get a country. The other thing is, just when I thought about Chad's great slide, where the Black woman is on her knees in front of President Wilson, and saying, Mr. President, why don't you make America safe for democracy? And the thing that few of us note is that, and I'll give a vignette, but I'll be quick. Wilson was at a dinner with the Queen of Romania, and he was bloviating, as most professors do, it was on and on. And she said, and he was talking about minority treaties. He said, if Romania wants to double in size, if Poland wants to have a good, secure frontier, you had all these rules. You have to sign minority treaties. All the new little countries that come out of World War I will have to have in their constitutions protections for minorities. And you went on and on. She said, finally, he went for a glass of water and she jumped in. And she said, Mr. President, what about the Negroes? He turned red, had another sip of water and did not reply. But here we have a man who's in Europe talking about, you don't get to be in the League of Nations unless you promise to protect Jews, gypsies, whomever, Magyars. At the same time, the same moment, the same week, And African Americans are being killed in places like Chicago or DC. It's amazing. And so Garvey was sort of saying, we need a state just like Jews need a state in Palestine. I thought I'd throw that in because the question was provocative. You know, why are we still complaining? He assumed without a state, we would still be complaining. Of course, we're not. Much. Okay. And I want to say just one thing to Ebony. Ebony, I was amazed because for the first, I mean, I know your work, but how prescient Chief Sam was, because if Garvey had worked out and people had actually gone to Liberia, what were they going to raise? And so by 1914, the Gold Coast chief product was cocoa, which is not, does not need to be a plantation crop. Most African Americans were not going to leave Detroit to work on a Firestone rubber plantation, but they could have become small scale cocoa farmers. And I'm just thinking with the acumen of someone like Chief Sam and the ballyhoo of Garvey, all due respect, it's unfortunate that they did not combine, because there was a small scale business model of peasant agriculture, which had made Gold Coast without European plantations, without European capital, become the world's largest producer of cocoa by 1914. I wish that had happened. Okay, so we have my time zone. We now have time for questions, and at the end, maybe tying some of this together, but let's get to the questions from our very patient audience. And if I guess if you raise your hand and I click you, you'll be on.
There may have been some questions in the chat as well.
Okay. Yeah. All right. The question. Yeah.
All right. Is it okay if I go ahead and
yes
ask a question? So
would you identify yourself? I see your name, yes. But yeah.
Scott Auerbach. I'm a professor at UMass Amherst.
Yes.
I just want to thank you all. My daughter is actually starting at Brandeis right now, and she's very, very happy there. So thank you all for taking good care of her. So I'm fascinated by the personal aspect, but also the philosophical aspect between the conflict between W.B. Du Bois and Marcus Garvey. And I'm curious if you see that the nature of that conflict between maybe more of the as you say, the orator versus the more kind of academic. Do you see that rippling through time as, and just in general, do you see that kind of taking place right now in some of the challenges, some of the conflicts for power as people are trying to figure out how to do the right thing?
Okay, well, I turn this over to the panel. First question.
Yeah, well, I guess I'll get us started on that very big question. I mean, I think it's important to emphasize that Black voices have never been in sync with each other when it comes to programs and ideas for Black freedom and racial progress. There have always been vigorous fights, debates, contestations over leadership, leadership strategies. So I think what we see between Du Bois and Garvey is really not that new. And it's certainly not a unique moment when we think about the larger duration of a Black freedom struggle. From the arguably the the 19th century up until the present. So I think we still, as I alluded to today, you know, have these questions about Black leadership, about strategies for Black protest that are shaped by a whole range of different factors, class, gender, generational divides, obviously ideological approaches. So without question, I mean, these are, this is an ongoing feature that I think the rivalry between Du Bois and Garvey was just kind of really viscerally encapsulated. But I think, you know, if we look at their specific approaches, their ideological approaches, and I'm sure both Robert and Emmy can speak to this as well. I mean, we see clear distinctions between the two, right? You know, Du Bois wasn't talking about Africa for the Africans. He was talking about elite Africans, you know, having certain rights, and maybe the rest of of African peoples, once they reached a level of civilization, you know, may be suitable for, you know, some type of restricted independence. So his idea of Pan-African uplift was incredibly elitist, was definitely top down, was very civilizationist in terms of his beliefs that African Americans needed to be the ones leading the movement, and everybody else needed to kind of fall in line after that. You know, Garvey had a much more broad based approach, you know, which was rooted in the explicit demand that Africans control their own destiny, right? So I think, you know, we need to take their ideological differences seriously, as well as, you know, when we expand, you know, that question to think about kind of the long duration of Black freedom movements, the different ideological strands and debates that have and continue to take place today.
I would add one thing to this question of leadership. It's such an important question. And Chad, I think you're absolutely right that Du Bois was an elitist in terms of a Pan-Africanist elitist. And I think Garvey was as well. I think he also had ideas that it was going to be diasporic Blacks who were going to be the senior partners in a transnational relationship amongst Black peoples. And I think Du Bois, in his later, by the time we get to the mid-1940s, he sees the error of that ways, that it's going to be Africans who are going to be at the forefront of decolonization movements. But I think what makes the ideas of both of these men both more broader and more democratic is the sense that the masses of people in both of their movements, particularly in the Garvey movement, took those ideas of Garveyism and made them more democratic and more sustainable. And the majority of people who did that were women. And that's certainly the case in the Garvey movement in South Africa. Mm-hmm. It is the women who are sustaining those independent Garvey churches and schools. They're doing the everyday work. And so in doing that, they're broadening the movement to make it a mass-based movement, but they're also democratizing it. And they're pushing back against the patriarchal ideas, the politics there. And I think that is where the leadership really is. As important as these two men are, as important as they are, their movements and their ideas were much broader, and people, particularly women, made them much more revolutionary and applicable to more people. And so when we think about leadership, at least that's how I think about leadership, and I think those are models of leadership that are the most effective and sustainable in this particular moment. Movements that are very democratic and often women-led.
Just one small point. Garvey accused Du Bois' collaborators in Liberia of slave trading. And there was an investigation that proved slave trading. And so you have Du Bois in 1924 talking about a Black-owned plantation with, quote, an endless supply of native servants, unquote. Garvey, for all of his elitism and costumes, et cetera, basically said, when we come to Africa, we're going to get rid of rampant labor exploitation. Mm-hmm. Now, he didn't have a plan, but he certainly did criticize black exploiters. And that was part of his downfall, that he actually said, I want to see rich black people, but I'm very disturbed by black sub-colonialism, okay? So although he praised capitalism a lot, he did have a kind of class consciousness which at that point, Du Bois did not have. Right. At that moment, Du Bois obviously went on and lived much longer and got a class consciousness.
Yeah.
Someone had their hand up and took it down. Okay. Suad Idrusu?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yes.
I'm Suad Idrusu, class of 2009. Good to see you, Professor Sundiata, Chad, and all you folks. My question, as you were speaking, you were kind of answering my question. That's why I took my hand down. But I'm actually really curious when your folks' opinion about was like kind of shift and what kind of brings that shift on in his later years and to the point where he goes to Ghana, where I'm from, and like actually lives out the rest of his life there. Just like I've myself do not necessarily in my studies have not necessarily figured out why that shift necessarily happened and when it started or because of who. So I'll, if there's any information be able to provide, that would be great.
Thanks. Anyone want to take that?
So the question is, how does Du Bois end up in Ghana, essentially?
How does he end up there, but when does that shift happen where he gains that class consciousness, where he changes, he moves away from the elitism of his thoughts? And I don't know if he actually did, but actually to end up kind of being, willing to like be in Africa and so not be like a master in a sense.
Anybody want to jump in? I think starting as far as his elitism, I think he was probably an elitist until his dying breath. But I think you see Du Bois becoming more radical, I guess, in terms of his class consciousness and specific embracement of Marxism really by the early 1930s certainly by the 1940s, he is very, explicit in terms of seeing the need for class struggle in conjunction with the need to address white supremacy. By the time that he ultimately makes the decision to leave the United States, live out the rest of his life in Ghana. He's really kind of on the margins of the mainstream civil rights movement. He's being kept at arm's length by the NAACP, other civil rights organizations. He is being hounded by the federal government. He's actually put on trial and deemed un-American. So he's kind of caught up in the web of McCarthyism. So his disillusionment with America and with American democracy by the 1950s by the early 1960s is very acute. So it's certainly kind of a gradual disillusionment. But from my perspective, you really kind of begin to see that shift. I would think really kind of in the aftermath of World War I, this war where he really invests so much into this idea of American democracy only to see the war results in mass disillusionment. So I think that's kind of the beginning of his really sustained questioning of just the very meaning of democracy and if it could indeed be applied to Black people in the United States. Mm-hmm. Himself included.
Suad, briefly. By the 40s, he'd gotten the message. But as late as 1936, he published an article in Foreign Affairs saying he had found the salvation of the darker races of the world. And he wrote an article praising Japan. Japan freed the colored races. Later on, he didn't talk about that much. But I would say that's in the mid-30s. By the mid-40s, he's getting on board. And he lived to be, you know, an old man. So it's a process.
I just want to interject here, and maybe it's helpful to distinguish what might be a kind of intellectual shift between the pragmatics of a relocation. And that has a lot to do with, and this is personally my approach to thinking about these things, how many people would move if they knew how to do it or if the path was paved for them by someone else. And so that is what happens, you know, in a sense that allows Du Bois to move, that he's given a house, he's set up, you know, his sort of, you know, food is brought to him and labor is organized. So in a lot of ways, you know, once he gets to the place where he's completely fed up with the US, it's also quite easy to transition because of his relationship to the Ghanaian government. And I'll just say this by way of personal story, because my father grew up going to his house for these Saturday lectures. And it's just, you know, and he only told me this recently and I was aghast. I was like, how have you been sitting on this my whole life? But, you know, he would say he was the old man, and we would go to his house and he would just hold forth. The room would be packed. People would sit on the floor and he would just talk extemporaneously for several hours on end. Now, on the one hand, that's just true to his academic nature to the end. He was very much about educating people in this lecture style. But on the other hand, you know, my father and many others felt that it was a chance to undo or to decolonize the mind, to think of all the different ways in which your thoughts had been shaped by a colonial system, and that it was not just about independence, but about a disentangling that was very careful, and that he was able to kind of give them a vocabulary and show them all the different registers on which the colonial situation had shaped their thinking. And he was forever grateful for that. So on the one hand, you could say that's a very democratic approach, but on the other hand, not everybody was there. You had to know somebody who knew somebody to be there. And, you know, he was lecturing. You were not sitting there peppering him with questions. So I think, you know, to honor Du Bois is to honor a complex character, and to understand him with many different facets that on some days appear deeply, deeply liberatory and democratic, and on some days appear fairly elitist.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's see.
Should I just answer the immigration tax question quickly, yes, since it's in the chat?
Right.
I think David Scott asked a question about cultural differences being more important to African leaders than race. I actually think we should clarify that the immigration tax was passed by the Legislative Council, which really wanted to vet not cultural differences, but capital. And so the idea is that they wanted people with money who were investors, who were coming with their own resources. And it's the same way, you know, in many places where you have to demonstrate you have a certain amount of money in order to be there. And so the immigration tax was explicitly phrased as something to prevent you from being a burden on the state, on the colonial government, which was quite thin at the time. And it was also to discourage. So it was a publicity maneuver to discourage mass migration. So I think it's less understood in cultural terms, because as I said, you already had so many people from all over the world coming to the Gold Coast to do business. These ports were just, you can just walk up and down the road in Salt Pond and see warehouses from Syrians, from Turkish, from British, from, you know, French, all these different companies that were setting up shop. So it was certainly not just about having a certain kind of cultural compatibility requirement, but rather having a capital requirement. So I think that's still true today in terms of who gets citizenship in Ghana. You know, if you're not married to someone, if you just move there and you're living there for a time, you may or may not get citizenship. But if you invest a lot of money, buy property and hire people, you have a greater chance of getting citizenship. So I would just maybe shift the emphasis to that.
Okay, we have 5 minutes. There is one question from one question asking about Garvey's nationality. Was the fact that he was an immigrant hurt him in the United States? Was that an issue, the fact that he was not an African-American? was not an ADOS, American Descendants of Slaves. You want to take that?
I think it hurt him. So on one level, it helped in the sense that there were many, at least in America, we're speaking just of America, it's time in America, there were many Caribbean migrants coming and who joined the movement as well. I think too, being a Jamaican, a colonial subject, Jamaica still part of the, really sharpened his sense of colonialism in a global sense and connected him to anti-colonial movements in Ireland and Egypt and elsewhere, in addition to Africa and the Caribbean. So he had a broader frame of reference, I think, that spoke to a particular characteristic of a Caribbean diaspora that was very mobile at that time, was very much at the center of Pan-African movements. I think it was slightly disadvantaged in the sense, disadvantageous because he didn't fully grasp all of African American history on this particular point. This might be an example. His meeting with the KKK leader, the Ku Klux Klan leader, was a bit tone deaf, not fully grasping that African Americans could not countenance any type of meeting with a KKK member, no matter how he was thinking about this meeting as being an enabler of his goals of Back to Africa movement, more Black autonomy. He was a bit tone deaf on that and how that would be very difficult to explain away to African Americans, given the particular history of the KKK with African Americans. So on that level, I think it hurt him. And of course, it made him susceptible to deportation as a non-US citizen, right? Which eventually separated him from the epicenter of his movement.
Right? Yeah, I think also, just briefly, I think the politics of color was something that also complicated his success in the United States, particularly amongst a certain class of African Americans. I mean, one of his critiques of Du Bois was essentially that he wasn't Black enough, that he was this mulatto monstrosity. So, I mean, he was bringing these ideas of class and color, you know, from Jamaica and applying them to the context of the United States and the race question in the United States, which was not necessarily analogous. And I think those tensions, you know, really kind of hurt him in the end.
Okay. Well, we now have 2 minutes, and in 2 minutes, I can barely say my name. And so I just want to thank, unless there's a question that someone could raise, and we could. One thing I will say is that Garvey's widow and Du Bois did meet in 1945. And they made peace and went to the St. Manchester meeting. And they, some people see that as a coming together of Garveyism and sort of Du Bois' integrationism. Actually, it was more or less the meeting of two people at a Pan-Africanist Congress. It was much bigger than these two people. They did shake hands and they were cordial, but Garvey had been in the ground for 5 years at that point. The other thing is that many times Garvey was called a Black Zionist, and he had a very strange relationship with Zionism. He would praise Zionists, in a way that today is so politically incorrect. Like, why didn't it happen before? Why are you waiting? Look what they're going to do to you. He wouldn't even say Hitler's name in the speech. He just said, that man will get us and he'll get you. At the same, so many people sort of said, well, if it's good for one group that's threatened, why is it not good for another group? And that was his basic question. Are we any more secure than they are? And of course, the answer is, close ranks. You understand, we're still here, and he had these great fears of a kind of, there was no word genocide, but he had a feeling that something really bad would happen to African Americans, that lynching and mob rule would increase as African American percentage of population decreased. That was his great fear. Just let me say this to the panel. You have done an amazing job And I really mean that sincerely. We just got an offer of money. So
yes, yes, please contact alumni relations, giving. I think I saw Alan Bertman in the room here. We are certainly more than happy to put your hard-earned money to good use in the AAAS department.
To a great institution.
Contribute to our ongoing efforts to create an endowed professorship in AAAS, among other things. So, absolutely.
Okay. Well, that was just the perfect note, Chad. That was the perfect note. We are now officially at the close of our program. I want to thank the alumni office, Courtney Sunkar especially, thank Napoleon Larison especially, who reached out to the Black alumni, and also to thank all the alums who tuned in and all the non-alums. This is still, you know, every day there's a new book on Black folk. And yes, we are still complaining because we still have racism. Because we still have racism, we are still complaining. And on that note, I will bid you all good night. Maybe, Courtney, do you have a few words you want to say? Because I'm trying to look at the time where I am. Whatever time it is, it has been really, really good to see you, to see my colleagues.